Welcome back, and it's hot and heavy. James Shannon returning with us on the Business Journal. This matter of the debt ceiling, the House Majority Leader Eric Cantor has walked away from the negotiations. He says that the president will not deal in good faith on this matter. Why can spending cuts not be a part of the active debate over the debt ceiling?
That's ridiculous. Spending cuts are a part of the debate. They've been enumerated. There's, you know, so many sacred cows.
Republicans say the White House won't come to the bargaining table when it comes to this.
There's a laundry list of spending cuts that have already been agreed to. I didn't bring the list with me. Here's the thing with Cantor. Cantor is trying to represent the Tea Party wing of the Republican Party, and in doing so, he's trying to triangulate his own speaker. Cantor wants Boehner's job. He wants to be the Speaker of the House. Cantor is an ideologue. He's positioning himself at the head of this ideological faction that doesn't care if the debt ceiling is not raised and it triggers an international monetary crisis.
Stories from Washington, Michael Truncale, continue to report that Republicans keep, you know, saying that the Democrats only want to talk taxes. They don't want to talk about spending cuts.
You have to talk about spending cuts. We cannot sustain this level of spending. It's going to drive us to be just like the nation of Greece. However, as I said, we cannot really consider tax increases because that will stall an economic recovery and keep people unemployed. So we must fight to keep those tax cuts, but in order to keep our own house in order, we must stem the tide of spending, and that's why we must hold strong on the spending issue.
A crucial question for all Southeast Texans. Anybody who has a home in Southeast Texas is going to be affected by this matter. It's the TWIA bill. It's a bit complicated. The Texas Windstorm Insurance Association, TWIA. It's vitally important. Debate is hot and heavy in Austin right now. We turn to our dignified panel for an important question. Why is Austin so reluctant to keep reforms in the TWIA bill without stripping homeowners of meaningful rights to some kind of legal remedy? Why is this mantra continuing to be played out that in essence would strip the people that are watching us right now of their rights?
Two reasons. First, TWIA only applies to 14 coastal counties. Mm-hmm. So for the other 240 counties in Texas and the people that represent them, it's not a big deal.
So we are not the squeakiest of wheels then.
Right. And the other thing is this thing about stripping the homeowners their ability to sue, it's ridiculous. In the fallout after Hurricane Ike, the reason there were so many lawsuits was because TWIA acted in bad faith to not settle these claims. The people down in Bolivar know full well they were offered 11 cents on the dollar. Mm-hmm. When it finally came around, these people lawyered up and got ready to start taking depositions at TWIA. They started settling the cases. So yeah, there was a lot of money that went to trial lawyers because that was the only way these people were going to get justice. TWIA said 11%, take it or leave it.
In other words, a lot of the most apparent popular bill out there right now, though, would favor the rest of the state, would not favor the coastal counties. It would strip homeowners of right to be able to do what they did after Hurricane Ike, which even now a lot of people are not happy about that. Let's go to Michael Truncale for
a lot of people,
TWIA.
A lot of Republicans in our state legislature are saying, what went wrong with TWIA? In fact, you know, they took premiums for years, and then when the storms came, there wasn't the money, and that may have precipitated some of these other problems. So that's why some are saying maybe it's time for government to get out of the insurance business altogether. On the other hand, there's some Republicans, people are all over the place on this, who say
Right. You
need to have some incentives to encourage a quick resolution of claims, but others don't want to go so far as to make it punitive.
Mr. Walston, it should...
Oh, you remembered, I'm here.
Should the state... how could we forget? Should the state of Texas get out of the business of insuring?
No, I don't think so. I think
especially when it comes to the windstorm.
Yeah, I think that eliminating punitive damages is going to hurt the homeowner, coastal residents of Texas.
Mm-hmm.
You know, insurance companies, some of them deal in bad faith. That's what those damages are there for, dealing in bad faith.
Mm-hmm.
TWIA did that. And this gave an opportunity for, you know, citizens to recover their losses and punish TWIA for their bad faith dealings. And I think it should still be in there.
And the fact of the matter is, these inland counties, where do they go when they go to the beach? They go to these 14 coastal counties.
Exactly.
Uh-huh.
If they want to rent a beach house and not pay $2,000 for it, then we need to have some protection for the people that have these homes down there.
And if it was managed well, hey, I think it was just mismanaged. I think if it was managed well, we wouldn't be having this problem we have now.
All right. On this matter of a social issue, we're seeing, and you know, we have two lawyers on the set today, so let's get into this question that has caused a lot of debate across the state of Texas, certainly. The judge in Corpus Christi, Texas, who brings forward a woman who says, who spanked, but left no marks above red marks, did no active injury to the child. The judge says, we don't spank anymore. Michael Truncale, are we surprised that we've come to this place where judges are now telling parents and grandparents, we don't spank anymore?
Well, this is a Democratic judge down there, and she has a certain view. I don't know that that's the view that most judges in Texas would hold. And, of course, again, you're talking about judges being activists, getting involved in our lives, and as Republicans, we don't think judges should exercise judicial activism.
Is Mr. Walston is spanking, is this a crucial issue that the judge should have, A, weighed in on, and B, what is an appropriate manner of discipline for Texas parents these days?
Well, that's up to parents. It's not up to the government to decide that. It's up to me as a father of my girls, uh-huh, if I want to spank my girls or not. Uh-huh. You know, I watched him on TV make that ruling, and I was just appalled, uh-huh, when he made it. And he told the woman, they took her children away from her. And there's two schools of thought. One says the child had a bruise on the buttocks. The other said there was a red mark. Either way, you know, where were these people when I was young receiving corporal punishment? You know, that's just the way that we were raised. This is Southeast Texas. This is not Connecticut. And for an activist judge to say, you are not allowed to spank your children as parents, I think it's crazy.
Well, James Shannon, these days we're starting to hear more and more people deciding to homeschool their children because of issues like this, where there's a fear that that the state in some way, a regulator, a CPS, if you will come in and have far more authority over a child than you know a parent would like to have. Have we jumped on the slippery slope from a social vantage point based on policies in the past?
Well, I don't think people are homeschooling their kids because they don't want them to be paddled. I know they still use corporal punishment in the Beaumont Independent School District, and I don't think that's what's driving the homeschooling. I think it's basically curriculum-wide, the desire to substitute their point of view, their view of history. We got the State Board of Education now weighing in on that. They try to de-emphasize Thomas Jefferson. They're still mad about that letter to the Danbury Church where the phrase separation of church and state first appeared. So they want to teach what they believe, just like people may watch a particular cable news channel because it reflects their political beat. But you know, this thing about the judge was a Democrat, I think this whole injection of partisanship in judicial races is wrong. I don't want a Republican judge. I don't want a Democratic judge. I want a fair judge that's going to abide by the law. Well, we've got a Supreme Court in Texas that throws out more than 70% of consumer cases where you do get a verdict.
And I got you.
You know, so they favor the company over the consumer.
We got to run
there. That's what political judiciary gets you.
Gentlemen, thank you so much. We appreciate it very much that you've been here. Right. And we appreciate your watching today on Southeast Texas Weekly. I'm Kevin Steele. See you next time.
London Broadcasting Company, Texas born, Texas proud.